Hi, my name is Meera Dasgupta. I am 17 years old. My pronouns are she, her, hers, and I'm from New York City. I am a youth advisor with the Human Impacts Institute, and I was the former United States Youth Poet Laureate with Urban Word NYC and the National Youth Poet Laureate Program.
Hi, I'm Ajani Stella. I am also a youth advisor with the Human Impacts Institute, and my passion is with climate education. I founded my nonprofit, Kids Fight Climate Change, where we bring youth climate education in a nonprofit completely run by youth. We're just going to have a conversation today about our thoughts about COP26. Yeah. Our conversations about power and privilege, but also how we can fix that for future conferences.
Yeah, thank you, Ajani. And I feel like we've had so many of these conversations in terms of COP as well. Like, we've been walking around the venue talking about these things. And we actually just came back from a protest earlier, the Fridays for the Future protest today. And Ajani, I was wondering, like, you can start about what you thought was good about COP and what you feel needs to be improved as well.
Yeah, so something that I feel is really great about COP is that we can see that there are other people in the world that are as passionate and are as caring as we are. It's so easy to think that we're just this bubble of climate activists. Everyone else in the world is evil, destroying the planet. But when we can have these just small conversations with people who really care about the planet. I mean, just wandering the halls, I was able to have a conversation with members of the International Renewable Energy Agency who talked about how energy is such an important part of the climate transition. We just had a really personal conversation. Mm-hmm. We've talked to other youth activists, and I think it's so important. But at the same time, I've had conversations with indigenous leaders and with you about how we don't all have access to COP. And there's this great organization that we were working with, the Human Impacts Institute was working with, that is dedicated to bringing more indigenous leaders to COP. But these leaders are not given a seat at the table. There's too many barriers to access and too many barriers to talking with actual delegates to get things done. We need to make sure that we aren't just tokenizing these activists. And I think that's the good and the evil of COP right now.
Yeah, and personally, from my experiences as an artist and also being with the Human Impacts Institute, which works at the intersection of art and research, I feel like from the communities in New York City that I've been a part of, I've seen how they've created these open spaces for youth and for intergenerational, interdisciplinary conversations, which I feel are so important, especially right now, because we have to not only make a seat at the table, rather, but we also have to make space for indigenous activists, indigenous youth and leaders, and make space for these translators, because I feel like there's not enough translators into different languages in terms of how many different people from different countries have to speak English, even though the language has also been a proponent of intergenerational traumas. Exactly. And at the same time, ASL, being inclusive to people with disabilities, I feel like COP could be so much better in those realms, and also being creative and finding ways to create solutions that are intersectional and take into account other people's lived experiences, because through my writing, I feel like I found a community, and there's a community here at COP, and I've seen so many young people here as well doing the work. And I think that our leaders also have to see this. They have to be cognizant of the fact that negotiations are for their constituents. They represent their constituents, and they also have to bring their constituents a voice at the table and not take or give them the voice that they already have, because they have a voice. They just need to be given the opportunity to present it.
I think that's such an important point you made there about remembering constituency, because our leaders are not representing mega corporations.
Yeah.
They're not representing billionaires. They're representing average everyday people. Indigenous activists are represented by the government. Youth are represented by the government, but our voices are not being heard. We are not at the negotiating table.
I agree.
Yeah. And our leaders just need to recognize that we have a voice. we know that they are not representing us. And we know how we can fill in a different bubble on election day if they don't listen to our demands.
Yeah, and Ajani, as we all know, you're going to be the next world leader. But at the same time, I definitely agree, and I feel like you said it. The leaders from the organizations that HII has worked with have said it, indigenous leaders have said it, but climate justice is racial justice, right. Is social justice, because there's so many different constructs in terms of like gender, in terms of race, mm-hmm. and we have to understand that though they don't exist in that way, they still impact individual lives. And they cause these many infrastructural problems because we have to cause societal changes because there's so many things that are ingrained within ourselves. I know that I have a lot of privilege being from New York City, and the activist community is so large there. We have so many opportunities. And at the same time, it's important to understand and acknowledge that we have to pass these opportunities on for those who will not only need it, but will use them the most, because I feel like their voices are needed, because this is not just dreams, but goals for these people who need to survive and who live every day trying to do their best, because we put so much guilt on individual consumption when hundred corporations make a majority of carbon emissions. And we need to talk about that. And I feel like having conversations like these are so important. And Ajani, you work in education, I work in arts, and I feel like that just goes to show how expression can be in a multitude of ways. And I feel like we need to have this call to action, because it's not just acknowledgement, but at this point, the future is now. We can't wait until 2030 for gradual change, and
we
have to find a way and solutions at the current moment.
I mean, just on that idea of solutions there, it's so easy to talk about all the problems that we have here at the conference and just with activism in general, but I feel like it's so important that we also talk about the solutions.
I agree.
As a 15-year-old, it is very hard to imagine how we could implement these solutions, because they just seem so far out there and far-fetched, right? But we have to remember, the United Nations has enormous resources at its disposal. COP26 has partner organizations that together are worth hundreds of billions of dollars. We have the resources and the abilities to invest in translators. We can have an army of translators in every single meeting room with the funds that COP has. We can allow indigenous voices into meeting rooms. We can allow voices from the global south. We can allow youth voices without skipping a beat.
Yeah.
Because we have these resources.
Yeah. And I just wanted to say that representation matters. Mm-hmm. Youth are not obligated to speak about these issues, because these are issues that we inherited. These are issues which have been perpetrated historically, and we have to continue to find these solutions, because I feel like they're there and they're in creative spaces, and we just have to acknowledge them. And in terms of funding, we have to create an overhaul of the distribution of our resources. Leaders have to listen, and listening is so important, especially right now, especially with closed doors, because again, representation matters. My parents came from India. They immigrated to the United States, and I often think about how these newer generations, as they're coming up, because I'm 17, Ajani's 15, and I feel so inspired just to have Ajani here too. But I feel like their youth are becoming so involved at the current moment, but our leaders, they have to acknowledge this fact, and the fact that they have to be a part of the solutions too, and they can't just, in terms of the barriers with COP, there's a world within COP, a microcosm within COP, which I feel expresses the world as it is at this moment, in terms of who's allowed in these rooms and who isn't. But it's more about not just talking, because it's so easy to talk. And I think conversations are important, but it's a two-way street, and we have to make space for other people to speak as well.
Yeah, I mean, as we're coming to the end of our time here, I just think it's really important that you made some amazing points there, just to remember that we have the ability to create solutions. We need to create these solutions now, because 5 years, 10 years, 20 years, that's too late. In COP27 and COP28, we need to be able to include voices from around the world, not just people who speak English, not just people who are who are focused on a single issue. We need to have intersectional climate justice.